Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the news tonight, where we get you the day's top stories from India and across the world in the next 30 minutes, all packed here. I'm Tracy Shilshi, and here are the headlines. Monsoon finally arrives on the Kerala coast. Government allays fears of an agrarian crisis worsening. Assure subsidies for farmers in case deficient monsoon affects the kharif crop. The NSC and Kaplang group claims responsibility for the Manipur attack in which 18 Jawans were killed. President urges the check on such attacks with a firm hand. Dhaka's all decked up to welcome Prime Minister Modi on his two-day visit starting tomorrow. Key deals to boost economic and trade ties expected to be signed. Nestle decides to pull Maggi off shelves despite allaying concerns over its safety, but the Central Food Safety Agency finds overwhelming evidence of the product being unsafe. And the US reports a massive breach of personal data of over 4 million government employees, suspect Chinese hackers. We'll get you all the top stories in a bit, but first our special focus this evening. Prime Minister Narendra Modi will begin his two-day visit to Bangladesh tomorrow. Buoyed by the land boundary agreement deal, the two sides would look forward to boost economic and trade ties further. However, the centre has clarified that the crucial Teesta water deal will not be finalised during this visit. Here are the details.
Bangladesh capital Dhaka is all decked up for the upcoming visit of Prime Minister Narendra Modi. Big posters of Modi and Bangladesh Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina have been put up and a grand reception is planned for him when he arrives on Saturday. Expectations are riding high after the long-pending land agreement deal was sealed during the budget session.
After 41 years, the historic LBA, that is land boundary agreement, that has been ratified by the Indian Parliament. And we have seen how the leaders across the political divide, they have said about Bangladesh. They stressed on a new relationship to start with. And I think that this spirit will lead us to resolve other issues, including the Teesta River and border issues and everything.
Boosting economic engagement and expanding security cooperation are likely to be the major focus areas during Modi's visit. Both sides are likely to sign a number of deals. The Prime Ministers of the two countries and West Bengal Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee will flag off two bus services connecting the northeast through Bangladesh. India hopes that with the border issue finally settled, Bangladesh will help in dealing with illegal cross-border activities.
For both countries, we expect improvement of the security situation on the border. There will be more trust and confidence. We think that it would be much more effective for us to deal with illegal activities across the border.
Despite the success of the land boundary deal, the key Teesta water agreement will not materialize during the Prime Minister's visit. West Bengal Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee had earlier resisted the deal during the UPA regime. Bangladesh Foreign Minister A.H. Mehmood Ali assured that talks are on at diplomatic level and the deal may soon be finalized. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
All right, for more on this, let's speak to Veena Sikri, who's a former ambassador joining us now from the capital. Thanks so much, Mrs. Sikri, for joining us. Give us a sense, really, of course, as being pointed out by the Foreign Secretary himself, LBA, the land boundary agreement, is going to be the crux of this visit. And that's really going to, you know, seal further ties between both countries, the warming of relations that we've seen, especially in the past 3 to 4 years.
Yes, I think the completion of the land boundary agreement process is a major historic milestone, I would say, in the relationship between India and Bangladesh. Actually, few people realize that it's not even 1974, which was the date of the Indira Mujib Accord, but the issues concerning this agreement go back to 1947. And in 1958, Prime Minister Nehru and then Pakistan Prime Minister Noon had concluded an agreement on the same subject because it was such a difficult issue between India and the then East Pakistan. Pakistan. Even though Indira Gandhi and Mujibur Rahman signed this accord in 74, it could never be brought to ratification by the Indian Parliament, because actually the delineation and demarcation on the ground were not done. Only when Sheikh Hasina became Prime Minister in 96, then for the first time the enclaves were demarcated. When she became Prime Minister again in 2009, then we had the delineation of the adverse possessions and the undemarcated boundaries. And then in 2011, when Manmohan Singh went to Bangladesh, then the LBA protocol was signed. But even then, it never came to Indian Parliament. Nobody quite knows why. Maybe some state governments were opposing it. And it's only now that Prime Minister Modi has been able to bring together the opposition parties, the state governments, and even the opposition within his own party to get a unanimous decision in the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha on this all-important question. Now, this sets the tone, because for the first time, with an important neighbor like Bangladesh, we have an agreed land border and an agreed maritime border, which was finalized last year through arbitration at The Hague. And now with this, the whole issue of connectivity becomes a new one. We are looking now at a sub-regional connectivity between India, Bangladesh, Bhutan and Nepal, which will cover West Bengal and the northeastern states in particular. Bus services, as you said, you know, Kolkata, Dhaka, Agartala, 500 kilometers instead of 1700 kilometers all around, you know, going around Bangladesh. Dhaka, Shillong, Guwahati. And then we are also looking at coastal shipping. We're looking at trade. We're looking at ships going in one day from Calcutta port to Mongla port and then coming up the river to Dhaka. You know, saving time, saving money, increasing trade. And we really hope that with the conclusion of the LBA, the border management issues between India and Bangladesh will improve considerably. Illegal activity should come down. And this border area, 4,000 kilometers, the longest border India has with any country, is a very porous border. It's actually an area of great poverty and only illegal activity. And we hope that with the LBA, we can have measures that will transform this area of poverty and illegal activity into areas of shared prosperity, you know, border hearts and connectivity through trains, through railways, through roads, and making the whole area a big hub of economic activity. I agree that maybe there was a hope that the Teesta agreement would be completed, but I can say I agree with the Bangladesh Foreign Minister that this is very much in the offing, and certainly in a few months it should be completed.
But then there is, of course, you know, some reports saying that India may actually concede Bangladesh's request to build a barrage on the River Ganga, especially with China showing, you know, some interest in it, saying that they would like to, you know, actually fund that proposed dam. So we may be seeing some work on that front. Anything crucial, apart from the LBA, of course, and the trade ties, that you're looking forward to from this visit?
Well, you know, talking about the Ganga barrage, I must say that this is a project that dates back to 1996 when the India-Bangladesh Ganga Waters Treaty was signed. At that time, India had recommended that Bangladesh, just as India has the Farakka barrage on the Indian side, that Bangladesh should build the Ganga barrage to augment water flows in the dry season and to help in the distribution for irrigation and so on. And India has always expressed readiness to help Bangladesh in the Ganga barrage. So I think it was in the Awami League manifesto in the last elections. So it's a good thing that they are going ahead with the Ganga barrage. I think that the LBA, I would like to say, is a great confidence building measure between the two countries. And I think the LBA combined with the trade aspects, you know, there's going to be a special economic zone, hopefully for Indian investors in Bangladesh, that they can invest there, they can manufacture, they can sell to Bangladesh, send it back to India or to Northeast India, or they can send it to third countries. So, you know, we're seeing the stage being set for this area of Northeast India and Bangladesh and West Bengal combined with Bhutan and Nepal becoming an area of activity and prosperity. The motor vehicles agreement that the foreign secretary spoke about, where, you know, cars and trucks and buses can move unlimited, unhindered between these areas. At the moment, most of the trade between India and Bangladesh, which takes place through Benapole, Petrapol,
seems to be,
land custom station.
By the looks of it, seems to be another successful trip that could be for Prime Minister Modi. Ms. Veena Sikri, thanks so much for joining us. I'm sorry we're running short of time, but thank you so much for joining us, you know, lending us really what is, of course, your expertise into that particular region and what has been the relations between India and Bangladesh for the past decades, in fact. In fact, a 41-year-old border issue now set to get sorted finally, but another one staring at us in northeast, which is, of course, from Myanmar. Naga insurgent outfit NSC and Kaplang has claimed responsibility for the attack that killed 18 army jawans in Manipur's Chandel district yesterday. The group with which the center abrogated ceasefire this year claimed a joint operation with the Kangle Yawol Kanna Lup and the Kanglepa Communist Party. Meanwhile, the army chief rushed to Manipur as forces launched a massive manhunt to nab the militants.
A day after a group of militants ambushed the 6th Dogra Infantry Regiment of the Army in the remote Chandel district in Manipur, NSCN Kaplang Group has claimed responsibility of the attack. In a release to media houses, it claimed that they attacked the army convoy with members from two other groups named Kangli Yawol Kana Lup and Kangli Pak Communist Party. On Thursday, it was suspected that a newly formed outfit of several militant groups could have been behind the attack.
मणिपुर में जिस प्रकार की सैनिकों की हत्याएं हुई हैं, उसको लेकर के आदरणीय प्रधानमंत्री जी स्वयं अपना वक्तव्य दे चुके हैं, इसलिए हमारा उसमें कुछ और जोड़ना ना उचित है ना आवश्यक है। परंतु एक डोनर मंत्री होने के नाते हाँ, ये जरूर स्वीकार करना होगा कि जो विकास कार्य हैं, डेवलपमेंट ऑफ नॉर्थ ईस्ट मिनिस्ट्री के अंतर्गत आते हैं डोनर में, उन पर भी एक प्रतिकूल प्रभाव पड़ता है जब भी कहीं हिंसा होती है, शांति भंग होती है। इसलिए हमारा भी दायित्व बनता है कि हम पूरा सहयोग दें, योगदान दें, और गृह मंत्रालय की ओर से हमें आश्वस्त किया गया है कि आने वाले समय में, भविष्य में, इस प्रकार की घटनाओं को कैसा रोका जाए, इस प्रकार की एक सकारात्मक योजना बनाई जाएगी।
18 soldiers were killed in the attack and over 10 were injured. Dimapur-based 3 Corps bid a final farewell to the martyrs who will be flown out of Imphal on a special plane to their native places for final rites. The army chief rushed to Manipur a day after the attack. The state government has already done a preliminary inquiry.
Manipur government side ki di ngarang makse koi FIR kan ta oda case restart ta ore adiga on the spot inquiry koi kan ta ore koi more gi SDPO Simba adiga tenokol gi osi gi yaudo mamun recept na koi spot inquiry sa charu re sa salu re mokoi ngana mokoi case restart ta ore
Condemning the ambush, the president has urged to check such attacks on security forces with a firm hand. Army is expected to launch a massive counter-insurgency operation. It has already been conducting search operations to trace and eliminate the militants involved in the attack in Chandel, which is 2 hours on foot from the Myanmar border. The border has been closed, but the security agencies fear the attackers may have crossed over. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
We'll keep a track of developments on that front. Meanwhile, let's give you some good news. And the monsoon has finally hit the Kerala coast today, 4 days behind schedule. The Met Office says favorable conditions will push it further inland over the parched southern states in the next 48 hours. With the prediction of a deficient monsoon this year, the government has assured subsidy on diesel, power and seeds to farmers if the crops are affected.
This is a sight that brings relief to not only those affected by the intense heat wave but also for millions of farmers across the country. Monsoon has arrived in Kerala, though late by 4 days. If all goes well, monsoon rains should reach the rest of the southern states by the weekend.
We can say during next 2 to 3 days there is a good rainfall activity likely over Kerala, even in Karnataka, even in Konkan, Goa and Madhya Maharashtra. Even that may be the pre-monsoon shower because the monsoon is not there. So we can say the initial stage of the monsoon progress will be good over Karnataka and South Andhra Pradesh and northeastern states.
The forecast of a deficient monsoon has raised concerns of farmers already affected by the unseasonal rains earlier this year. However, the government assures it is ready to tackle any situation if monsoon plays truant.
अभी हवामान खाते ने 2 महीने पहले बोला था कि बारिश 100% से ज़्यादा गिरेगी. अभी वही हवामान खाता ये बोल रहा है कि बारिश 80% गिरेगी. तो सेतकरी ने अभी किसान ने पूरा खेत तैयार किया है और वो जो बता रहे कम बारिश आएगी या ज़्यादा आएगी तो एक उनमें करेक्टिव होना चाहिए, तो किसान को मालूम होता है कि अपने खेत में कौन सी फसल लगाना है।
हम हर तरीके से मेंटली प्रिपेयर्ड रहे कि कोई अगर मान लीजिए आवश्यकता पड़ती है, हमारे प्रधानमंत्री तो ऑलरेडी उसके लिए इतने ज्यादा यानी प्रिडिक्शन करने से पहले ही जो है उन्होंने तो हमारे को कैबिनेट मीटिंग में सब लोगों को सब विभागों को कहा कि भाई सब अपनी अपनी, आपने देखा कि एग्रीकल्चर मिनिस्टर ने भी कहा कि पर्याप्त हमारे पास फूड ग्रेन्स है, सब चीजें हैं, कोई किसी तरह की कोई पैनिक का तो कोई कारण नहीं है।
To allay fears of a bad crop year, the centre has promised to offer subsidy on diesel, power and seeds to farmers. Dismissing concerns, the government assured that it is fully prepared to face a drought-like situation.
मैंने बताया कि बिजली के भी कंटिजेंसी प्लान बन गए हैं और राज्यों के लिए पहले ही से अधिक एलोकेशन है, ये स्थिति होती है तो बिजली चालित पंपों को और उस पर हम कुछ रियायत भी देते हैं, डीजल पर भी रियायत हो तो अलग विषय।
पिछले साल डीजल पर रियायत दी थी,
हाँ दी थी, हाँ बिल्कुल बिल्कुल, डीजल पर, बीज पर, चारा पर 70% सहायता देंगे।
Unseasonal rains earlier this year badly damaged rabi crop, causing massive loss to farmers across the country. The government will soon decide on minimum support prices for kharif crops, which the farmers have already started to sow. The centre will be keeping its fingers crossed that El Nino does not impact the monsoon any further this year. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And now, days after controversy over the safety of one of their most popular brands erupted, Nestle finally reacted today. The company's global CEO asserted that Maggi is safe to eat. This came on a day when the Central Food Safety Regulator, the SSAI, ordered it to withdraw 9 variants of Maggi from the market.
The Maggi noodles in Nestle India are safe for consumption.
More than a week after the controversy erupted, Nestle has come out with a clarification. But even as they claimed the instant noodles were safe for consumption, they withdrew the product from the Indian market.
Thank you very much. Trust has been shaken and therefore is not inducive. We felt to have our product on the shelf. And it is now our intention and with the consumer in mind that we're going to work and do everything in our, what it takes, everything that it takes. To work also and to clarify with the authorities the situation and to have the Maggi noodles back on the shelves.
The decision to withdraw came after Maggi was banned by several other states. Central Food Safety Agency FSSAI says tests have found overwhelming evidence that Maggi is unsafe.
जिन लेबोरेटरीज से सैंपल टेस्ट हुए हैं वो उन टेस्ट रिपोर्ट्स को क्वेश्चन नहीं कर रहे हैं। सो इन हालात में अगर मैं अपने सामने मेरी एक ऑथराइज्ड लैब है या एक कॉम्पिटेंट लैब है उसकी रिपोर्ट आती है तो मेरे लिए उसको मानना सही है। जब तक कोई उसकी पराकाष्ठा पे या उसकी औचित्य पे सवाल ना उठाए।
जो सेफ्टी स्टैंडर्ड्स के दृष्टि से जो रेगुलेशंस हैं उसका वायलेशन हुआ है, लेबलिंग रेगुलेशंस हैं उसको मैगी ने फॉलो नहीं किया है, इसलिए उसके बारे में भी उनसे कहा है कि इसको भी रिकॉल कर लें। और मैगी ओट्स मसाला नूडल्स एंड टेस्ट मेकर यह भी प्रोडक्ट बगैर अप्रूवल के मार्केट में आया था।
FSSAI ordered recall of 9 variants of Maggi noodles on Friday as many more states banned the product. Nestle shares traded off the day's low on Friday after falling as much as 5%. This week Nestle has fallen 15% because of the controversy. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
With that, let's get you some more news updates from across the country and nationwide. Tamil Nadu Chief Minister Jayalalitha filed nomination for by-elections to the R.K. Nagar Assembly constituency today. Thousands of AIADMK workers gave her a rousing reception all along her way to the office of the returning officer. She needs to be elected within the next 5 months to keep the Chief Minister's post after being acquitted in a disproportionate assets case. Police resorted to water cannons to disperse Sikh groups staging a protest outside the Congress headquarters in Delhi today. They were protesting against reported clean chit to party leader Jagdish Taitler in the 1984 riots case. Protesters gathered raising demands for action against him. They also sought the resignation of Congress President Sonia Gandhi. The Jammu and Kashmir State Police's clamped Section 144 in Jammu a day after a youth was killed and 7 injured in clashes with police. Several protesters took to the streets for the third day today over removal of posters of Khalistan militant leader Jarnail Singh Bhindranwale. Curfew-like situation prevailed in violence-hit areas of Satwari, Ranibagh, Kadigar, Arespura belt as well. A quick break here, but still ahead, Prime Minister Narendra Modi pitches for a greener earth on World Environment Day, initiates program to plant trees across the country. And the Archery Association of India pulls out of its team to the World Youth Archery Championships in the US after 21 members were denied visas.
Midday meals for school children. 120 million beneficiaries. State approaches to the program vary, as does the menu and food mix. Who should have the final say on this? Watch The Big Picture at 9:30 p.m. on Rajya Sabha Television.
Welcome back. Now, the India and Netherlands have decided to set up a joint working group on counterterrorism. The two countries have set a roadmap for their cooperation in diverse fields, including infrastructure, investments, agriculture and renewable energy. Prime Minister Narendra Modi and his Dutch counterpart, Mark Rutte, held talks in Delhi today on a wide range of issues. The visiting leader expressed support to the ambitious Make in India program, including in the defense sector. Modi also announced e-visa for tourists from the Netherlands. Modi and Rutte addressed a joint media interaction later, describing the talks as comprehensive and productive, and said they discussed bilateral relations as well as global and regional issues of mutual interest.
We agreed that we both stand to benefit from closer bilateral and multilateral cooperation, including in areas such as countering terrorism and extremism, defense, maritime security and cyber security. We have agreed to set up a joint working group on counter-terrorism, which will hold its first meeting on 19th June.
Prime Minister Modi has ambitious plans for economic growth and has announced major initiatives like Make in India and Clean India. The Netherlands is a key partner in helping India achieve these goals and to learn from India so that we also can apply these lessons in the Netherlands. Indeed, our two nations have long-standing ties.
Meanwhile, President Pranab Mukherjee returned to India late last night, winding up the two-nation tour to Sweden and Belarus. The visit was aimed at strengthening India's bilateral economic ties with both countries. It was also the first visit by an Indian head of state to both the countries.
On the first leg of his two-nation tour, President Pranab Mukherjee visited Sweden. While in the country, President Pranab Mukherjee held delegation-level talks with Swedish Prime Minister Stefan Löfven, discussing bilateral and multilateral issues. India and Sweden signed agreements for cooperation in the field of micro, small and medium enterprises, besides an agreement on visa exemption for diplomatic passport holders.
Sweden is an important partner with whom we have shared multifaceted and mutually beneficial relations over several decades. Combining Swedish resources with India's young and growing market offers synergizes that can spark a fresh phase of growth.
In Belarus, on a two-day visit, the President signed 7 MOUs between India and Belarusian universities and institutes. Calling his trip to the country fruitful, the President said Belarus was a key partner for India.
Belarus is a key partner in the wider Eurasian region with many strengths. India-Belarus relations are based on goodwill among our people for each other and a positive legacy of cooperation in multilateral fora, including at the United Nations.
Belarus is pressing for greater Indian investments in the manufacture of pharmaceuticals. Several commercial agreements were also concluded, and the two countries have set a target of $1 billion bilateral trade in the next 5 years. Bureau report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And pitching for a greener earth, Prime Minister Narendra Modi took the lead in the government's program to plant trees on World Environment Day today. A host of ministers and prominent citizens also took part of the initiative across the country. And one of the largest carbon emitters in the world, India is home to some of the most polluted cities, and it is expected to announce a cut in carbon emissions during the crucial climate talks in Paris later this year.
मैं आज पर्यावरण दिवस पर देशवासियों को यही प्रार्थना करता हूं कि इस मॉनसून में हम भी हर परिवार के अपने वृक्ष हो.
7 billion dreams, one planet, consume with care. Prime Minister Narendra Modi endorsing this year's theme for the World Environment Day. The PM started the plantation drive by planting a sapling at his Racecourse Road residence lawns. He also placed an earthen pot along with the sapling, a traditional way of conserving water and ensuring that sapling has regular water supply.
हमारे पूर्वजों ने हमारे लिए किया, हमारी जिम्मेवारी है आगे वाली पीढ़ियों के लिए हम कुछ करके जाएं.
Delhi CM Arvind Kejriwal also took to the drive by leading his cabinet colleagues and state government officials in taking a pledge to support environmental conservation. He also planted a sapling at Delhi Secretariat. The Environment Ministry has invited eminent sportspersons like Sachin Tendulkar, Virat Kohli and Sushil Kumar to participate in country-wide sapling plantation drive.
इस मुहिम का प्रारंभ किया है.
मुझे बहुत खुशी मैं यहाँ पे आया और मैंने पहला पेड़ लगाया.
रिपोर्ट सजेस्ट दैट इंडिया हैज सम ऑफ द वर्ल्ड्स मोस्ट पोल्यूटेड सिटीज. WHO had ranked Delhi the most polluted city in the world. India's participation in the upcoming climate summit in Paris will be closely watched this time around. India is expected to announce cut in carbon emissions following footsteps of US and China. Bureau report, Rajya Sabha TV.
International news, and the US today reported a massive breach of personal data of over 4 million government employees. US investigators suspect Chinese hackers to be behind the cyber intrusion. Meanwhile, China has dismissed the allegations, saying they are not responsible for this.
The US has reported a massive cyber attack on 4 million government employees from nearly every government agency, the biggest breach ever of the government's computer networks. The US has traced the breach to the Chinese government, claiming hackers working for the Chinese military are behind it. It is not clear what the purpose of the database is. China has refuted allegations, saying that they are baseless and irresponsible.
类似的报道，类似的言论，近期我们看的比较多了。但是它科学吗？我们讲网络黑客攻击，它具有。
America discovered the breach in April during an updation of its cybersecurity systems. The information stored on OPM databases includes employee job assignments, performance reviews and training programs. OPM serves as a human resource department for the US government. This is not the first cyber intrusion into the US database. Earlier in November 2014, a hack compromised files belonging to 25,000 employees of the Department of Homeland Security, as well as thousands of other federal workers. Bureau report, Rajya Sabha TV.
With that, let's get you more international news in Global Buzz. Pakistani officials have admitted that 8 out of the 10 men convicted and jailed for trying to kill Malala Yousafzai were allegedly acquitted in a secret trial later. Malala was shot in the head by Pakistani Taliban militants 3 years ago. The militants were convicted by an anti-terrorism court, slapping a jail term of 25 years. Greece has delayed a key debt payment to the International Monetary Fund today. The IMF said Greece planned to bundle 4 payments due in June to a single 1.6 billion euro lump sum, which is now due on the 30th of June. It was the first time in 5 years of crisis that Greece has postponed a repayment on its 240 billion euro bailouts from the Eurozone governments and the IMF. The Chinese cruise that went down with over 400 passengers has been finally hoisted out of the waters of the Yangtze River today. Authorities say that 5 days after the tragedy, there are no more chances to find any survivors. Just 14 of the 456 passengers and crew are known to have survived China's worst shipping disaster in over 60 years. The death toll from an explosion at a gas station in Ghana's capital Accra has climbed to 150. The explosion was caused by a fire that erupted in a nearby lorry on Wednesday night and then spread to the gas station and other buildings in the city. Ghana's president described the loss of life as catastrophic and announced 3 days of national mourning from Monday. And finally, let's change tracks and get you the latest from the world of sports. It was a mixed day for Indian shuttlers at the Indonesian Open Super Series as Parupalli Kashyap stunned world number one Chen Long to enter the semi-final, while Saina Nehwal bowed out of the quarter-final. Kashyap staged a phenomenal comeback to win 14-21, 21-17, 21-14. However, three-time champion Saina went down fighting 21-16, 12-21, 18-21 to Wang Shixian of China. The Archery Association of India pulled out of the World Youth Archery Championships in the US as a mark of protest after 21 of its team members were denied visas. The team was denied visas on apprehensions that they would not return to India. The Indian contingent was scheduled to leave for the US tomorrow for the tournament. Stan Wawrinka has reached the men's singles final at the French Open after beating Frenchman Joe Wilfried Tsonga in 4 sets. Swiss world number 8 defeated his counterpart 6-3, 6-7, 7-6, 6-4. He will meet the winner of the second semi-final between world number 1 Novak Djokovic and Andy Murray. Football's world governing body FIFA faces more pressure after it confirmed that it paid Ireland's Football Association $5 million to avoid a legal case over a controversial World Cup playoff defeat in 2009. Ireland were knocked out by France in a two-legged playoff to qualify for the 2010 South Africa tournament. The decisive goal was scored after a handball by French striker Thierry Henry in extra time. And that's all we have for you on the news tonight. From the entire team here, good night.